Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. If you're new, my name is Monica. I am a tarot reader and astrologer based in Cairns in Australia. And today I am doing a video response to Don Michelle from Boho Tarot. Don Michelle recently did a really fun and interesting video with the hashtag #ItTakesAVillage2022, where she talked about her different tarot decks and how they each fulfill a different role. And so all those roles together constitute her tarot village. So she uses a different tarot decks for different types of readings, for different issues, different concerns. And I really related to that because I do that as well. She also mentioned how she changes her tarot decks based on the seasons, which for me is not so applicable because I am based in the northern coast of Queensland here in Australia, and we have essentially two seasons, one being very, very hot and the other one being just hot, okay? But that aside, I do find myself reaching out for the same tarot decks when I'm faced with a particular type of a question or a scenario or a setting. And like Don Michelle, I can agree that each of those roles or archetypes together constitute my tarot village. In the role of guide, I have two tarot decks, the Cosmic Cycles Tarot by Miriam E.G. and the Unfolding Path Tarot by Athena Arcana. Now, these are tarot decks that are really my personal decks, and I work with these for any personal issues that I have. They're my go-to for advice on any sort of day-to-day questions or concerns that I have. So first up, I'm going to look at the Cosmic Cycles Tarot. This is a wonderfully refreshing and modern tarot deck, and the reason I reach out for this deck so often on a regular basis is that it is so relatable. In particular, here with our modern lives, I think a lot of the imagery in this tarot deck, a lot of people can really, really relate to and understand some of the challenges that the protagonists go through in this tarot deck. It is modern, it is diverse, it is so expressive and beautiful to work with. I think that the scenes, like I said, most people could easily identify with some of the characters in this tarot deck, their joys but also their sorrows. I like how it is vibrant, but it's not too superficial. In fact, it holds a lot of wisdom despite the way that it is drawn, which I really like. I particularly love this type of illustration or art. But most of all, I could really relate and identify with some of the protagonists in these tarot cards. Like here in this Eight of Cups, I could totally relate to this lady going for work and leaving her baby in the care of her partner, or in the care of someone else, full stop. And the look on her face, you know, like, I've been there. I will never forget the first day when I had to go back to work and had my oldest put into daycare at the time. It was so heartbreaking. And I was fortunate in that I only had to do that a couple of days a week, but still, that these images really, really spoke to me, and I think that they're showing everyday scenes that most people go through, right? Being there too, crying in my pillow, being in charge of work, in projects and things like that. I think that it shows different types of roles within the deck, and it's got young people, it's got mature people, it is diverse as well. But overall, it's just really refreshing, it's fun, and it reads exceptionally well. And of course, it is a Rider-Waite-Smith tarot deck, which for me, it is basically a must at this point in my tarot journey. The other tarot deck in the role of guide is the Unfolding Path Tarot by Athena Arcana. This is a tarot deck that I was fortunate enough to obtain off Kickstarter, and I congratulate myself on an excellent purchase. The Unfolding Path Tarot has a different vibe to the Cosmic Cycles Tarot, but nonetheless, it is a brilliant deck for everyday tarot readings, for my personal readings as well. I fell in love with the expressions of the characters in this tarot deck. They are so alive and wonderfully illustrated. And can I just say, using the Page of Cups as an example of the diversity in this tarot deck, particularly when it comes to age. And in this card, the artist makes a brilliant demonstration of the qualities of the Page of Cups and how they're not so much dependent on your outer look so much as in your inner state of being. You know, that young at heart expression comes to mind when I see this Page of Cups. It is stunning. I love how expressive the people are. Like, they're human, right? They have wrinkles, some of them, they've got tears, you know, they pull their hair in frustration and pain and sorrow. It works really well as a reading deck. Again, this is a Rider-Waite-Smith tradition deck. I love the artwork, but even beyond the artwork, like, there's so many tarot decks where the artwork is stunning, but here it's functional, right? These characters, I can relate to them, basically. I can understand their facial expressions and their mannerisms and the energy or the vibe that they give off. It's, again, very, very relatable to me. It shuffles beautifully. I love this buttery sort of cardstock feel to it. And yes, I think that it's a really well-executed tarot deck for day-to-day pragmatic readings. I've used this over and over again, and it never disappoints or fails for me. So this is a firm tarot deck that falls within that guide, you know, your personal guide, archetype or role. In the role of caregiver, I have two tarot decks, and I have the different versions for each year. So although I have four tarot decks in front of you, they're really only two. On the left, it's Songs for the Journey Home, and on the right, it's the Gaian Tarot. Songs for the Journey Home is a New Zealand tarot deck. It was created by two Kiwi ladies by the names of Dwariko von Somaruga and Catherine Cook, and the Gaian Tarot was created by Joanna Powell Colbert. Songs for the Journey Home is a round tarot deck that comes in two different sizes, a mini version and a large version that I will use to illustrate why I love this tarot deck so much. But first, before I go on, I want to talk about the role of the caregiver. To me, when I think of the caregiver, I cannot help but think of the ultimate caregiver. And without sounding too cliche or fluffy or light, I want to say that to me the ultimate caregiver is our Mother Earth, who nurtures us all, who gives us so much abundance and blesses us with incredible richness. Everything in our world comes from her. And so the caregiver function for me fulfills that soothing, nurturing quality that really alleviates my anxiety when the state of the world really gets to me. The first deck, the Songs for the Journey Home, really talks about the choices that we make in our day-to-day lives, in our relationship with Mother Earth. It is a hand-illustrated tarot deck that shows different settings from day-to-day life, but also with a more spiritual undertone to it as well. And It is beautifully illustrated, in my opinion. It has that particular art that isn't perhaps too polished, but it is so human. This is the tarot deck that I turn to when I need to work with that energy of nurturing and care of our Mother Earth, when I need to make the right decision as a conscious human being and make the right choices. So here is a brilliant example of that. We have this person faced with two options. One is more nature-based and one is a cityscape. Now, I'm not saying that one of these trumps the other. I think that for some people, being in a city is really conducive to their creative well-being, right? Whereas for others, it is a nature-based setting. But the point is that you must really think carefully about the choice that you make, and make that choice to align with your core and your purpose in life, so as to, that you don't waste your life or become lost. But the imagery might not be obvious straight up, some of the meanings, but you sit with it for a while and it has sort of like layers that open up. And so when I need a bit of spiritual TLC, when I need my anxiety to be a bit alleviated, this is one of the tarot decks that I turn to and I work with almost exclusively. And I find that even the colors are really soothing. They're not too jarring, but they're still expressive and colorful in their own way. This image is one that makes a prime example of what I mean about our relationship with Mother Earth and the nurturing that goes on. And we've got a woman breastfeeding a baby, but we also have these beehives and the bees and the bird and, you know, the grains, and everything just is so expressive of that cycle that keeps on going, of that give and take, of change, but we're supported in that change and all the fruits from the earth that we are given. Also, in the role of caregiver, I have the Gaian Tarot by Joanna Powell Colbert, and I've got two editions here. On the left is my indie edition and on the right is the Llewellyn. I'm going to work with the indie edition because the cards are bigger, but this is the indie edition of the Gaian Tarot. And again, the name itself, the Gaian Tarot, refers to Gaia, Mother Earth, and the deck is infused with that particular energy. But it is such a vibrant tarot deck. It is filled with joy. It is filled with the highest attributes that we as human beings can contribute to our society and to Mother Earth. As conscious consumers, as conscious beings, this tarot deck I obtained many, many years ago, and it is one of my ultimate tarot decks when I need a tarot deck that needs to fulfill that role of caregiver, but also of pointing me in the right way, making the right decisions as a human being, right? And as a human being that is part of a community, because I'm often quite solitary by nature, but this deck encourages me to partake in community a lot more than my other tarot decks, and reminds me of the importance of forming like-minded bonds with other people. So it's a wonderfully nurturing tarot deck, and for me, I use this deck again for both practical questions but also for more spiritual or self-development questions. And what really works with this tarot deck, like with some of the others, I keep on going back to that idea of them being relatable, right? The people in the cards to me are everyday people. They're common people. They're humble people, but nonetheless, they're people that offer a richness and experience in life, and they embody their spirituality. They embody their knowledge, their wisdom, you know, their connection to the earth and to their community. Like, this is another community type card, so is this one. So yes, the guy on tarot is a firm caregiver deck in my collection and will remain so for a very, very long time. Fulfilling the role of the counselor is the golden tarot. Now, the counselor is a tarot deck that I use for those times when I'm dealing with immediate issues from my immediate family, my marriage. So it's a predominant relationship tarot deck. And it was created by an artist by the name of Cat Black. The Golden Tarot is a collage deck. So the artist used artwork from the late Middle Ages and the Renaissance period predominantly. And she picked different elements from different paintings and put them together to form the tarot card. For me, any deck that falls within the role of the counselor needs to fulfill a few functions. That is, it needs to be a Rider-Waite-Smith tarot deck because I'm very familiar and comfortable with that system, and I need the boundaries of that system to provide a real, really stable guiding force for my readings. The artwork needs to be keeping in line with the Rider-Waite, but it also needs to work really well and be structured. It can't be too diffuse or anything like that. And it needs to be like a grounding sort of an energy, because when you're dealing with immediate relationship, immediate family issues, there's a tendency to lack objectivity and to be highly subjective. And so I need a tarot deck that pulls me back and enables me or supports me to have an objective framework as much as I'm able to do. So it's quite a lot to ask of a tarot deck, but I find the Golden Tarot is a really, really wonderful addition because it fulfills all of those elements. And of course, I love the artwork. I am not usually a fan of collage, but as you can see from these images, it is so beautifully done and so sensitive to the Rider-Waite-Smith tradition. But with that Renaissance or late Middle Ages art style, and as the name suggests, the Golden Tarot, there's a lot of gold, beautiful color choices. It's not garish, it's actually a little bit subdued. But I absolutely love that personally. These are sort of my colors. So for me, this tarot deck works really well for, as I mentioned, relationship questions and pragmatic questions. And because it keeps with the Rider-Waite-Smith tradition, it is so easy to read with. It's easy to relate. I understand this tarot deck really well. So in the role of counselor, is the Golden Tarot by Cat Black. For the next role, I'm looking at the Priestess or the Mystic, and I have the Dark Goddess Tarot. The Priestess role is for those times when I'm predominantly doing ritual work and I need to work with a deity or a goddess for the purpose of that work. It's usually when I create an altar and I dedicate an altar and I make offerings to spirit and to a particular deity that I'm working with, requesting their help, requesting their presence or requesting their protection, or sometimes simply offering my gratitude. The Dark Goddess Tarot that I have here, this is the indie edition. There is a mass market edition out there as well because the indie edition is out of print. I don't have the mass market one, so I can't speak on the quality of that one. However, this indie edition is absolutely brilliant, and I have worked with this tarot deck for many years now, and I am in awe of how much substance and power it holds. As the name suggests, it is a tarot deck that showcases different goddesses from all over the world that might not have the most pleasant reputation. Some might be feared, some might be dark in nature. But I have found that if you come to the table working with this deck in a respectful manner, if you bring substance and if you're honorable in your dealings with it, it is a deck of tremendous power. And it's a tarot deck where you need to allow time to work with it. It's not a quick exchange, I find, with this tarot deck. It's also one where things aren't what they seem on the surface. So let me give you an example here. I saw the Banshee before, the Nine of Air. Now, earlier on in the year, I requested a goddess to work with for my tarot work, for my consultancy business, right? So this is for my work as a reader. And the idea behind it was to draw a card from this tarot deck to have a goddess that I work with, that I work with in ritual. I create an altar for, and I do some readings and form a bond with, to support me, to offer guidance and protection and resources to me as a tarot reader, to basically bring forth my tarot reading ability. And the goddess that I drew was the Banshee. So I picked up the little booklet that comes with this tarot deck. I know the mass market version has a full book, but I don't have access to that, and often I refer to the booklet that comes with the tarot deck. And when I looked at the Nine of Air for the Banshee, what do you know? Well, she is the Irish spirit of prophecy. And the little message says, if you would know, do not fear to see. And I was so struck at that time, because what better description can there be for a goddess that you request to work with in your work as a tarot reader, as a seer, you know? So anyway, that's just one very small example. I have quite a few others that have left me speechless. And so, yes, this is an incredibly powerful tarot deck for ritual work, and it fulfills that priestess, that mystic role for me beautifully. And it's the one that I return to time and time again in my work as a high priestess, essentially, when I need to set time aside and connect with a deity and to learn from them, to honor them, and to form a meaningful exchange. This is the tarot deck that I use on a regular basis. Up next, we have the role of the elder. Now, I remember Dawn Michelle talking about the elder. One of her elder decks is being the salty grandma who takes no nonsense and, you know, pulls you in line. And to me, the deck that fulfills the function of the elder, it's perhaps not as salty in its wisdom or in its approach, but it's certainly an elder deck, and that is the Heindel Tarot, created by the German artist Hermann Heindel. I have had this deck since the beginning of my tarot journey. I think it was the second tarot deck that I bought. And for me, this tarot deck has been an incredible wealth of richness and wisdom. And it is very much like the elder in my tarot community. And even the imagery feels ancient. Like, I feel there's a ancient vibe to this tarot deck. Interestingly, this is a bit of an outsider as well in my community, because it is Thoth based, number one, and I'm not a Toth fan. And number two, it has keywords on the cards, which I'm also not a fan of. And no other tarot deck that I have has keywords, because for me that's such a turn off. And yet, this deck is a beautiful exception to the rule. I mean, the imagery itself, if you look at this imagery of Spider Woman, if that's not an elder energy, I don't know what is. Right, even the labyrinth and the painting behind on like the rock art, it's absolutely stunning. Do not be put off by the pip cards, because there is a book, in fact it's written in two volumes by Rachel Pollack, that goes into this tarot deck in depth, like really in depth. And about the artist as well, you learn a lot about Hermann Heindel, who has a fascinating history himself. It's not my story to tell, but I highly encourage anyone who has this tarot deck to look into those books. So to sum it up, in the role of the elder for me is the Heindel tarot, and it will always be thus. In the role of teacher, my study deck is the Herbcrafter's Tarot by Joanna Powell Colbert, who also did the Gaian Tarot. I am working with this tarot deck because herbs, both for medicinal purposes but also in ritual magic, herbs are something that I am interested in, and I want to get into in depth a lot. I find that the essence and the ethos of this tarot deck goes beyond herbs. It's a tarot deck that highlights a way of life. Okay, here we have a ritual. And it doesn't show people as such, except for their hands in the court cards. But it's beautifully illustrated, and it shows people and how they interact with herbs as ritual, in their harvests, in their making medicines and potions and brews, as this card suggests. What also drew me into this tarot deck is the energy of the homes or the places where the medicine or the magic is prepared. Lots of wood-fired stoves, lots of glass, earthenware and clay, lots of wicker baskets, and no plastic. I think that this deck is really a testament to a relationship with Mother Earth that honors the mother, that doesn't degrade the mother through the use of tools or objects that will pollute the mother once they are done with their use. And there's so much of that, in particular in plastic use in our lives. And it basically really spoke to me because of that, because I just so relate to that. It's something that I strive for every day, and no, I'm not perfect in it, but it's something that I want to emulate. And so this deck really helps me to follow that path in my life, to learn about herbs, but also to craft my own life in this particular fashion. But one thing I gotta really point out that this tarot deck did really well is it matched the numerology with the type of herbs. Okay, so for example, if you're looking at the nines, you know, if you look at numerologically from 1 to 9, 9 being the end of a journey, well, the 9 cards are about fruit trees, or plants, trees that give us fruit. And think about the fruits of your labor that comes through in the 9 of Pentacles, for example, in the 9 of Earth, that sort of thing. So I really like the way that it marries those concepts. So my teacher tarot deck is the Herbcrafter's Tarot by Joanna Powell Colbert, and it is a beautifully illustrated tarot deck that is also very functional. The role of the stranger, I have the Somnia Tarot, which I only acquired last week. I've already done a video on it where I did my new deck interview spread to form a bond with this tarot deck and to work with it. Although, to be honest, I always knew right from the start that this deck holds significance for me. The Somnia Tarot was created by Nicholas Bruno. It is a photographic tarot deck. So Nicholas did all the photographs for the tarot deck and the props for it. And the deck was inspired from his dreams, his nightmares, and also his experiences with sleep paralysis. There is something about this tarot deck, the atmosphere, the way that the characters aren't obvious. You can't see their faces. They're either shrouded or they've got their backs turned or they're covered in some way. There's something about that that really draws me in and wants me to spend time with it. I feel like this is not a superficial tarot deck. Well, I mean, it's not. You can tell that the artist has put so much thought into creating these images and so much work that went behind it. So that is the Somnia Tarot in the role of the Stranger. Finally, the last tarot deck is the Jolanda Tarot, who for me fulfills a role that is particular to me, and that is the witch. So I don't have a muse and I don't have an outsider, but I do have the witch. Now there's an element of that salty old grandma in the witch, but it's a bit more than that. Witches, they've been feared and misunderstood for a long time. And I think when I think of a witch, I think of someone that is an outsider in some ways, deeply connected to nature, understanding of the divas and the elementals in the natural world, with knowledge of plants and herbs and their medicinal and magical properties. And so the Jolanda Tarot is a really interesting addition to my collection. Interestingly, this tarot deck, I think initially it was called a Swedish witch. So even though the deck has Hans Arnold as the creator, because he did do the artwork, but the deck was co-created with a Swedish witch. Her witch name is Jolanda. Her real name is Rosie Björkman, I believe. She lives in Sweden and lives in a tower. It's fantastic, and runs workshops from there. And if money was no object to me, and if my kids were all grown up, that's where I would be. So the Jolanda Tarot is a bit different to other decks in the way that it is drawn. I'm not sure that it follows Rider-Waite-Smith per se. I think it possibly follows a Toth, but I need to delve into that. And I mean, this is the thing, I've never really followed exactly which tradition it follows, because the images are, some of them are just oddball and different and weird. And yet, it fills a particular niche where when I need a question asked, when I'm working more with pagan magic, or when I'm working more with the creation of talismans and amulets and things like that, and when I need my intuitive muscle to be flexed, this is the tarot deck that I reach for. But sometimes I think that, like, it really throws me off, and I like that. It's unsettling. It's different. It asks me to think and not just go for memorized meanings, right? It asks me to really, really think, really use my intuition to arrive at an answer. So this is the witch in my collection. She's a bit different. She's a bit wise, she's a bit salty, a bit long in the tooth, a bit, you know, can be a bit churlish. Perhaps if you ask stupid questions, she'll give you stupid answers or just whack you over the head and tell you to grow up. But, you know, like, here's an example, the Three of Swords, where you've got this fly or this flying insect caught in a web. And the tears are breaking that web free, right? The symbolism is, it's incredible, right? And each card has a bit of that symbolic magic that you really need to sit with to understand. So in the role of the witch, to conclude my tarot village, I have the Jolanda tarot. So I'm going to wrap it up here. I feel like I've rambled on enough. But first of all, thank you to Dawn Michelle for her wonderful video and for the idea. It's fantastic and it is wonderful. And I really enjoyed watching her video and also creating my own. And as always, I thank you all for watching and supporting my channel. Until next time, thank you.